Okay, here we are again. Happy as can be. All good friends and jolly good company. So we have a small group. It's kind of rainy out there, but we have some seekers. That's the magic. So who would like to start off with a question? See, I love the questions because it enables me to go down like after the whatever it is down that hole there. Like a mongoose to a snake, so to speak. So I can, if you could just ask the question, what's the matter with me? Now you in the front row, you...
Beretta,
yeah. You're getting better after a terrible life that you've been living, correct?
Yes.
It's been awful. And you were talking to me about something, and I'm absent-minded a little bit because I'm absent-minded. I get older. As I get older, all the things that are not important disappear. Names of people. Remembering things, forgetting the past, not caring about the future. I seem to be focused down only in what's in the moment, and I can respond to it with a smaller vocabulary. It seems like the truth can be... See, you've got to be careful of a lot of words. There's a lot of intellectual words. They've got to come down very small and make everything really simple. Yes?
I have a question.
Okay.
Okay, Roy. So I'm coming here, and I got a ride from somebody, and this person was late. And...
It looks like you're troubled.
Yeah, well...
I can see it on your face.
Yeah, well, I'm feeling so justified in my anger. I can feel
You're not
that.
Justified in anger any time.
I know, I feel
it's
that,
It's simple.
Though. But it's so strong.
But they, well, you're so wrong.
I know.
Because you entertain it. You know that anger is your Waterloo.
In my words, I know it's wrong, but that thing is still like sitting there, just sitting there feeling
yes,
justified.
But you see, the thing is what makes you angry.
Yes.
And it causes you to be judgmental, like you were God.
Yes.
See,
I feel
so
right.
Therefore, you don't do as I tell you, off with your head, which is
yes,
a judgment.
That's what it feels like.
Yes, because that's the thing inside you that is, well, opposes as you. In other words, you're God.
Yes.
It's all about you.
It is.
You're God.
Me being right.
But you're not really God. It's the thing that makes you think you're God. That's how it works, works through you.
Yes. I feel like, oh, it's so gross. I feel like God, yeah. But it's almost like that's just words when I say that. Because that thing is so strong. That thing is...
No, it's not. You give it strength.
I am.
No. You give it strength. It's not strong. It's feeble. It feeds on you. It feeds
it
on you by seducing you into thinking its thoughts and its will is your thoughts and your will. Can't you see that?
I can.
I mean, you don't have to be a genius to see it. I talked to a 6-year-old kid and I understand it.
So I'll just sit down and feel it.
To make it clear, everybody has another self. Eve, let me just put it this way. The most dangerous creature on earth is a female. You've got to be very careful, gentlemen, about women. And you ladies have to be very careful about yourself.
I feel that in myself.
Because there's something in you that wants to overtake the man.
Yes, I do. I feel that because it was a man that I was getting a ride from. And he was, and I felt myself just, but I was sitting there, coming here, and I felt myself... wanting to rule, or I don't know if the word
it's
is...
It's not you. See, listen, you talk about myself, you speak that way. See, but it's no, you don't have a myself. The my has you. In other words, it's inherent.
Does.
It's inherent.
What does inherent mean?
Means it's inherited.
Oh, yeah. It's ingrained in
it
me.
It goes through the generations. Through one man, sin and death through sin spread like a pandemic throughout the whole human race. And through one man, all that goes out. And the human race waited for a long time for the whole world to be infected and the numbers sufficiently to make a kingdom of heaven or a kingdom of hell on earth. You can't have a kingdom of hell on earth with two people. So all the misery and all the suffering, it has to be.
I see you, and you're so happy. You're happy, and I feel myself.
No, I'm not happy.
Well,
I'm not miserable. I'm not happy. What am I? I don't know what I am. I'm just here sitting here looking at you.
Well, I feel myself being. I feel myself being the opposite of you.
Yeah. As a matter of fact,
I could be there, but I'm here.
Say that again.
For some reason, I'm choosing to be here, and not the opposite.
Why can't you just look at your?
Okay.
Why can't you be aware enough all day long and just watch yourself?
Okay.
Just watch yourself and you'll see endless loops of thoughts. You'll see irritations. You'll see judgments. And if you see them, which is called perception, see the difference? Perception isn't with your eyes. It's with your intuition. Intuition is the opposite to outtuition. You must be everybody on earth. Everybody on earth must be self-educated. In other words, you don't put a kid in a school or you don't teach your kid anything. You just see what he wants to learn and help him, provide the book for him, provide them the little games he wants to play with, which means he's going to learn how to put things together. And watch him and then guide him away from the nonsense stuff. But the children by nature want to know about everything. They're looking at this, they're looking at that, and pretty soon they're settled on something, and off they go. And then goes from one thing to another. You don't have to educate a child at all. You only have to leave him alone and stop spoiling him and let him make his own money.
And adults too.
And give him a job. And then pay him a quarter. And just suggest that he saves it until he has two quarters and three quarters and then buy and sell or buy something he wants for himself so it's his. Okay. Who understands that? I'm not an educated person, thank God. Education is poison. It does not mean that you won't be educated, but you have to be educated. Means that's the Greek or Latin, I don't know which one it is, but I know it means to bring forth from within. Bring forth from within. A child comes in the world busy, busy, busy looking. Leave him alone. Stop pushing him. Stop spoiling him. But you can't do that until you whole yourself, because you can't see it. Because you think if you push him hard enough, he'll do some work. And if he starts to being pushed, he starts to resent being pushed. And he rebels and he wins or learns nothing, etc., etc. Or he tries to please you and fills his mind with all kinds of intellectuals and gets degrees and he doesn't have a soul. The knowledge of good and evil. Just look how brilliant the Bible is. The knowledge of good. That's language. You think in languages. Don't think in language. Just walk down the street and just look at things. And a blade of grass. I don't know, a leaf falling from a tree. When I remember the first time I saw it, there was a spinning seed from a tree. Do you know what that tree is? It spins, mm-hmm. a helicopter, you know. And I see, that's how that's it. And then I see, you know, a dandelion. How did that happen? How does it create a parachute? How did it think that out? Well, these things are marvels. And it's inspiring, not outspiring. Now, I can remember the first time I thought that way. I would like to have, how does a tree know how to make a tree? I just would like to know. I never did find out, but I found out other things. That was, it's just a question. I know I would, it's not important. If it was important, I'd know why. But it wasn't for me. It was what I'm teaching now. It came to me during the war. How did Hitler control so many people and turn them into murderers? And how is it done in so many places, right? The whole world is full of people who fight for them, for the Führer. How is that? How did they get to be a Führer? How does one person control so many and turn them into murderers and killers? So I started learning about hypnosis. I'm not very good at school. I look at my teachers, they're walking dead. Now they made a movie out of that. I said, it's just, the teachers are walking dead. I couldn't learn anything from them. I was fourth in my class, was only four in my class. Dead people walking around. No, I let my kids find it their own way. And none of them went to school. I took them out. But while they were there, I say, if you could just have to disagree with, if you lose your exam and you see that what the teacher's saying is teaching you is wrong, you have a right to stand up and say, no, I don't. Or just put it aside, and it's better to fail in school than fail in life. Or succeed in life. Succeed in school and fail in life, you see. So, yes.
And there's plenty examples of...
Can you stand up?
Yes.
Just a little bit, if you mind, thank you.
There's plenty examples of that, of what you're speaking of very highly successful people that didn't do well in school and didn't even go to college.
Absolutely.
Einstein was an example, right? He did.
Oh, thank you. I'm an Einstein too. Because I've written my interest after discovering the magic of everything is going on and understanding how the mind works and how the mind is broken by the spoken word and the authority of the world. But the authority of the world doesn't know how to fix what the authority of the world does. And nor do they want to find out. No matter what department it is, it's psychiatry, psychology, it's education, they don't want you to find out. If you're a preacher, they don't want you to find out. They just want you to listen to them on Sunday. Well, spoken words, that's all.
Yeah, and the Bible says to pray unceasingly, and you just mentioned how, you know, why can't you just watch yourself all day long.
Yes.
So what is it that the church is missing about that pray unceasingly? I did some research a while ago, and the root of prayer came to examine oneself or watch oneself. So that makes perfect sense. It's not talking to God all day long, for heaven's sakes. I mean, you're going to look like a crazy person. But why is a church, they've just missed it totally.
Because... to make it simple, when you come into the world comes into you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you're really not guilty. You're not guilty as Adam was. God, if you made Adam and Eve over and over again, there wouldn't be anything. He knew, God knows, that he cannot create love. God cannot create love because that makes it a compulsion.
Right.
See? So you have to be tested.
Yeah.
Okay, the first man is tested. And in God knows he's going to fail.
Right.
And he's not pissed off. He just throws him out in the garden and used. And then it begins.
Right.
And so the first family is the first murder. See? It begins.
Yeah. But you were talking to Catherine about the thoughts that it's not heard. That's really the test, because I realize in my life the deceiver was talking to me as though it's a master masquerader. That's its whole game.
Yes.
But once you see that, and it's easy to see.
It's easy.
Yeah, once you see it.
But do you want to see it? Do you want to see it? Or do you want to hold on to it and feel proud and judgmental over everybody?
Not after you said
you're a stupid woman then.
Right. After.
Then die.
I don't want
to. No, listen to me.
I hear you.
Then die.
I hear you.
Hey, how old are you?
50, almost 54.
You've been that way for 50 years?
Yes.
When are you going to give it up? When are you going to go on listening to that sick thing inside you that came through being born into it? You have a choice. You're not guilty. It's guilty.
Uh-huh.
So if you feel guilt, there's no guilt for you. It's guilt for it. And when you see it's not you that's guilty, you're free. How simple is that? But you psychiatry today, psychology today, and medicine today, they don't understand what's going on in the head. They don't understand that this is coming through the generations. So that's the reason why Jesus says out loud, "Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do." We do know what we do when we start to become conscious as kids. So your two-year-old is smarter than a 50-year-old. The two-year-old is much smarter than you.
Yes.
She can see, oh, Dad shouldn't be having sex with the lady in my bed. She knows all about virtues already. She sees right and wrong, but she doesn't know how to deal with it. She's not strong enough. She's a little baby. She depends on food and care and clothes. So she's stuck with all the pressures, and she has to obey. But this is not something of her choosing. This is compulsion. And the parents haven't found it. Their parents haven't found it. Every now and then, the Ten Commandments, it has that. Honor your mother and father, that the days may be long on the land the Lord thy God giveth thee. See? But then it goes off to say something very interesting about the third and fourth generation that love me and keep my commandments. Got it? So what I'm trying to say is, you can't hate your mother and father because they do not know what they're doing. And no one's ever told them what I'm saying to you. Nobody wants to hear it. Everybody's born in sin, and then, everybody's a sinner. And therefore, you can do what you like as long as you believe in Jesus. He lets you off every time. No, it doesn't work that way at all. Salvation is like that. Salvation is not going to school or to church because it turns you into a religious nut. Yes, a person who is addicted to church, like a drug addict to the pusher. You go to church and the preacher tells you how wonderful you are and how saved you are, and it's nothing of the sort. You're just believing. Okay, you're okay. Believing, and everybody has, in every religion on earth, it's the same thing. You listen to the teacher, you're going to go through all kinds of things. Locally here in Grants Pass, this is how they work. Now we should now, let's pray to Jesus. Ooh, 5,000 people. Jesus. And they're all doing it. They're mesmerized. And they all feel so much better because they've forgotten what a bunch of bastards they all are. See? They can't see how they've been had. You cannot see you've been had. So you've got to see you've been had. And that is the light. Simple. If you don't want to see it, you ought to keep your judgments because you have a sense of superiority. It's a sense of worth that's utterly worthless and will kill you. And you paid the price. You got 50 more years to live. Start now. So, if anybody tries to make you guilty, I am trying to get you to see the guilt. But the guilt isn't yours. Listen carefully. The guilt is not yours. The guilt belongs to the thing. How can I say this? It's an identity.
It is.
I don't know how it works. All I know, it can multiply itself through the multitudes.
Its strength multiplies.
Yes, and it gets a sense of elation, a sense of
validity.
Yes, sense of being somebody when you screw somebody's head. Especially people weaker than yourself, because you can't do that to people stronger than yourself. You already had it done, for which reason you do it to somebody else. And it goes right down the chain, cause and effect. So he cries out, "Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do." Now, do you go to church and really understand what that meant? Do unto others what you would have them do unto you, but you don't know how to do that yet because you've been screwed. Your mind has been changed and it gets inside you and it multiplies. Every time you listen to it, it multiplies. And every time you fight it, it's like the person that put you in your misery.
It grows.
It grows all by itself. So if you sit in a cell for 20 years, you come out crazy. Because you'll be fighting with yourself and arguing with yourself and making yourself miserable.
Yes.
Trying to make yourself better. See? Well, now what do I have to say for yourself so I can blow my nose?
I hear you. It makes it smaller when you talk. It's dissipating, but it's still there, but it's dissipating.
Well, it's still there, but it's nothing. If you understand, it's nothing. It's only something you give it the power to make you feel important.
Uh-huh.
Because you see, once you've been corrupted, once you've been corrupted by being born into the world, and the world is now into you, right? But the world coming into you, coming through your parents.
Made to feel small. I've always been made to feel small.
What it does is put something inside you that disconnects you from God, and establishes,
I see when you say disconnects to God.
I have to wait a second. There's a place of holiness inside you, and it will displace that holy place and sit there. See? And then it has a power as if it was God. Because you've separated from God and you can't get anything from him once you have changed sides. And it's not difficult to screw a child's head by beating him and lying to him and making him dependent upon you, codependent, and giving him, spoiling him, confusing him, confounding him, and you don't even know it. So a child coming into the world gets all that in the head and displaces the holy and puts the unholy in the place of the holy. Now, that thing now begins to feed on more of that self. First of all, it comes in and separates you from God. Now, God can't get to you because it is in the way. But still, you're not guilty. Because you've been tricked. You haven't done that purposely. You weren't born in this world and did it purposely like the first person. The only human being that ever lived that is guilty, and he will be excused one day. He will. Because he did not know not what he does. He didn't understand that the dark side of Eve. I warned you about Eve. Ladies, I don't mean to be rude, but you're freaking dangerous. Because once you, especially in Obama world, where the women have all the power, and all you have to do is stand up for yourself and you're in jail. All she has to do is irritate you, and she has the right to have no-fault divorce. So there's something of Eve in her that needs Adam. But the spirit of Adam, not Adam, man born of woman, is nothing. A female born, that slips right into her. But a male child born of woman is violated the day he's born, just by the fact that the woman is giving the love. But it's the men that love, the men have the power to love and women don't. And they're looking for a man, the real woman, never mind the not real ones, but the real ones are really looking for a man to say, no, put the fruit down, Eve, you can't have your way with me.
That's what I see about my own self right now, is that I have a grandson who's two. And his mom and dad, when I babysit him, and then anyways, there's three of us in the room, and the dad wants him to kiss him, and the mom...
Say it again.
I will.
Say it again.
The dad says, give me a kiss goodbye to the little boy. The mom says, give me a kiss goodbye. And then in comes me. And I don't kiss on the lips, so I try to, it's an ugga mugga.
Yeah, kissing on the lips is not good for a child.
I know, but my point is, so this little boy, oh God, I just saw that I'm trying to make him love me through that spirit that you're talking about. Hold on, let me get my voice back.
Yeah, first of all, you're talking about you as a child.
No, I'm talking about me as me right now.
Oh, okay. So it just
my grandson, I can see that spirit which you're talking about, trying to get a child to love
him.
Ugh. It's so horrible.
To try to get it
to love the thing inside of me to make it feel like what you're saying is. Everything you say, you've said to Catherine, is what I just have been seeing, and I've seen it. But then I just saw yesterday how I'm trying to take something from my grandson to fulfill that spirit.
It's life force.
Blah, I know that, and so...
But why would they do it? Because they lost their own life force.
Of course.
They have to live on your life force, and they have to tease you to get it.
Of course.
And then it grows, and you become them, and you become a little bit like them. And then you turn around and do it to somebody else,
of
but
course.
You try not to. And if you don't, which you're the kind of person that doesn't want to take
it. No.
You don't want to do it, but you're giving up your life.
Hold on.
See? And you can't replace it. And you start to eat a lot and have all kinds of problems.
But here's the beauty. It is being replaced. Inside of me, there now lives the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
So that thing is still snacking on me and still hurting other people through me. But I'm also see that And so I'm only crying right now because I know that that thing is still working through me. But in the process, I know that it's also dying, but it's still getting there.
It feels like you're dying. Does it feel like you're dying?
Well, of course, no, I know that it's not me. I can see, Roy, that I can see that it's not me. I know that God created me. And so I know that I have the Holy Spirit inside of me.
Yes.
There's just a separation that's happening because...
There's a disconnect.
There's a disconnect because... Yeah. I'm sorry, I just don't want to be so stupid.
Now just hold it, give it a pause, and understand that all you need to do is sit quietly, and he connects. If you struggle with it, it's a thing that makes you struggle and takes your attention in the wrong direction.
I don't feel like I'm struggling with it. I feel like it just has to die, and it just really doesn't want to. So I go through this a lot.
Say it again.
Let me see if I can say it again. I feel like... Hold on, there's something coming through me, so that's good. I know that it's dying.
Well, it's
and
not.
I feel like I'm not struggling with it.
It doesn't really die. It simply retreats back to hell with greater guilt than it came into the world.
Okay, so then thank you for saying that. So I think I've heard you say that, it'll shoot out someone's toe, or I've heard someone say it came out their ear and then went back in. So
it can affect different parts of your body. I understand that.
So I think there's a part of me that thinks that there's this spirit like you see in the movies that's going to come out of me and I'm going to watch it and say, see ya.
But it doesn't come out, in a sense, into the world. It disintegrates. It only has the strength you give it. It only has the strength you give it. Let me see if I can just make a point from my point of view. And maybe you can measure you against me. Is that all right? I've told you my story of not locking the door. You know, I was about 16 or 17. And so I locked the door before going to work. And I was sure of it. I went downstairs and it says, don't lock the... You didn't lock the door. And, okay, that's I thought that's me. So I went up there, I just locked the door. Yes, it was locked. Okay, so I get on my bicycle, halfway there, 5 miles. But you didn't lock the door. Now, I had a good parents, so I had approached me differently. So I wasn't messed up. My brother's messed up because he's jealous of me. When my father died, he became jealous of me because he thought my mother loved me more than him. But I was the older person to take charge, see that, basically. But he hasn't seen it. He has been so hateful that he's dying to this day. He made up all the bad stories, all the good things I did for him, like I was his dad. And he made up lies and told his kids and all. He's a huge mess. But the point is, I'm different. I'm carefree. My father dies and I take charge. And my wife, my mother would look to me for that, which was very good. If I was 5 years old and she looked to me and asked me my opinion about things, I'd be able to talk to her intelligently better than her at 5 years old. It would bring the man out of me. Because men have that quality. But the trouble is, man born a woman, subject to the woman. And he doesn't have God, it doesn't have, the fact that he's born of woman means that the woman ruins him just by being born. Because you ever see a woman with a baby? oh, isn't he wonderful? Right? Wrong. Why can't you look at the baby and say, isn't he beautiful? And not have a feeling. So when you have a feeling, you're taking it from a child. You're taking it from a person. So that what they think, what they feel for you, you feel for them. And therefore you're dependent upon the feeling to feel anything at all called some pseudo-righteousness. And so you see all this business as rigmarole, or she has a relationship out of wedlock, and she hates the child in her womb. You see, and she hates giving birth to this kid because, well, she wants to live a better life, and I don't want to take care of this kid. Thus, she's had her sex, she's had the pleasure, now she's got a baby, she wants to kill it. Look at 50 million of them. 50 million murdered babies. See? So that's how wicked they are. Do you think men want that mostly? No, it's women do that. Women are the murderers. Women are the killers. But if it's a man that loves the hell out of her, but men don't know how to love the man out of her because they're born of woman and subject to the woman. And then they, and so that when they get older, they go back to the woman, like going back to mother, having sex with mother. That's what it boils down to. And it's disgusting. It's really deliberating. That's not the right word. What word am I looking for?
Debilitating.
Yes. So, but the man has to understand this. There's nowhere in the world that says the things that I say. I don't know anybody that speaks like this. Men don't have it. They've lost it the day they were born. But they still have it within them. But the compulsion as they get older, because they never had a father that was able to overcome the Eve in the woman. You see, when a man looks at a woman and is influenced by her, attracted, he's attracted in this attraction is in two ways. I need a sense of worth, or you love the woman, you're patient, you don't look for the pleasure, you don't look for the love that tell you how wonderful you are, you don't look for the pleasure that makes you feel better than you deserve. In other words, she's not an ice cream sundae. See, she's a human being. You can't play with that. You can't get something from that. You dare not get something from that. But who knows about that? You always talk about sex as love. It isn't.
But that's where I feel like, for my own self, then.
But you see, it dovetails with you. It dovetails with you. It dovetails with you.
What does that mean?
It means it synchronizes with what you're talking about. Looking for someone to love you and somebody wanting to make you love them.
Yes.
And they pull on you, and they pull on you, and they irritate you, and you give in. And then they reward you for giving in, and that's giving you love back. And in the beginning, it feels like love, but now it becomes you begin to have to give yourself it to get them to say something nice to you, and whatever it is you have to give it up because the source of who you're growing to be is giving into the dark side of that person.
Well, now I'm on the flip side of that.
Yes.
So there's God. God has shined His Holy Spirit into myself.
Yes.
So now, I'm just undoing. Now
yes.
I have to undo all this.
Yes.
Stuff.
Yes.
So I don't feel like I'm fighting with this thing. Mm-hmm. I just feel like when I come here, there's maybe not that there could be more power than God. So I don't want to say this wrong, but there's just an energy that this thing can't handle, and
my energy.
It's God's energy.
Yeah, but energy that's coming through me. That's why you're here.
Yeah.
That's right.
Is it? Because it's also... And you recognize it. And you recognize it. Now, all you have to do, if what I am saying, if I'm representing what good is for you, I love what I'm doing. You understand this? I'm not looking for you to ask. I'm never asking you for anything.
Nothing.
Nothing.
I don't have anything to give you.
That's right. But even if you did, I wouldn't ask you.
Right.
Okay, I like to do it. And the more I do it, the more I love doing it. So if I have to walk around in rags, I'll still be doing it.
Because it's the spirit that's coming through you that now I recognize because it's coming through me.
But here, listen carefully how beautiful this is.
Okay.
The fact that you can, it takes one to know one. So that what I've done or what is happening through me to you is you recognize where I'm coming from and you're happy. It validates what you lost as a child. That's all there is to it, as far as I'm concerned. There's not much more to it than
what
that.
What else is there? I understand that. Mm. I understand that you have one piece of light. The darkness is gone. There's no more darkness. There's
Yes.
That's nice.
Now you're on your journey. Now you're on your journey to become perfect as your Father in heaven is. But remember, you've got to read the Bible very carefully. And becoming perfect isn't instant. Only God knows everything at once. You can't know everything at once. You can only give you what your part is of the story that you will unfold to appreciate him. Because your life is a story, either from the bad side or from the good side. So you're swapping stories.
Yeah.
One comes out better. It doesn't mean to say that you are perfect yet. It's a becoming one. It's every second. It's every mini-second, okay? And every mini-second is you have no, you know that this thing is inside you, but it now knows that you know, see? And so it can't trick you anymore. It will try. But as long as you keep it, the idea that you've already been redeemed of it, see, you know you've been forgiven, don't you?
Yes.
But then there's some mess left over, right?
Yes. Yes.
All right. That mess must be cleaned up.
Yes.
And it has to come to the surface and come to the knowledge of the light.
Yes.
And you can't decide, go to a psychiatrist and say, which one is going to come up first. It's all magical. Take the word magic and really believe that what is saving you is metaphysically magical. So you do not know what is going to come up next. You do know not what situation you will meet, what complexity there is in it. All you need to do is be aware of what you're being. Just be aware that everything wants to seduce you, everything wants to screw you and hurt you, to demoralize you and confuse and kill the spirit inside you, or relationship with the spirit inside you.
I'm more worried about not that person of their hurting me because there's a protection, I already know that, but it's what's left inside of me makes me mad, I'm sorry, that I don't want it to hurt anybody anymore. I don't care that it's in there, son of a bitch, it's in there rot, and I don't care, but I don't want it to hurt anybody.
But don't get angry, see, it's angry.
Okay.
See the anger?
Uh-huh.
Even expressing it, it comes with anger, and it compounds the problem.
Okay.
Let's just say it now, let's say that again quietly.
Okay.
Say it.
Hold on.
It's in there.
Yeah.
Okay, is it in there?
Just a minute.
Yeah, but just listen to me. You don't want to hurt anybody.
I don't want to hurt anybody.
Okay. But look how you just expressed it. I don't want to hurt anybody. That's just tricked you.
Yes, it has, and I can see that.
See it?
Yes, I can.
Now you see it, it goes away.
Okay.
See? It's all the little tricks. And you're going to have to see those. As it made you do all these different things and
yes.
Compounds It compounds. And it compounds in such ways that no human being can possibly ever, ever understand it, let alone fix it. It's a fix. And every human being has anxieties and fears, and it takes drugs to make themselves feel better, have sex, smoke dope, anything to take away the pain of what? The distance between you and God. See, so you're closer to hell than you are to heaven. So the whole journey is to begin to move in that direction, and you feel clean. There's a certain cleanliness, a cleanness of feeling free to be able to see, free to be able to see. That is it. And if you let the light shine on, for instance, you just got angry because you don't want to hurt anybody. Right. See, but that's not good. Or you have to say, I see what you mean. I don't want to hurt anybody.
And it takes its own identity even through that.
Even through that.
Yeah.
That's how clever it is. Now, you see, if I hadn't learned all these things, I couldn't tell you. It's me just, I'm following you. And I'm listening to what you're saying. And every time you say something, I'm showing you something you couldn't see, but I see it. Then I share it with you. You got it. It takes one to know one. So that's it. So all you need is to listen to me until you no longer need me. I don't want you to need me, because I'm only telling you the beginning of the end of that dark side of you and the beginning of your life. And the beginning of your life is all within you and nobody else. Nobody can tell you. You don't ask, you don't talk to psychiatrists, you don't talk to... Whatever you do, though, the little thing you've learned is to be irritable, not to be irritable. So you're sitting in an airplane and you're going somewhere. And you say, my name is... And what's your name? And I say, what do you do? What's your business? Yeah, it's a conversation. And so somehow you bring it around. Yes, I used to have anxiety. You have anxiety? Yes. Would you say, let me tell you what I did with mine. Pretty soon, you can find out, because the person next to you is either a very deleterious person or a good one, looking for love, looking for understanding of one person. So you only have to have one little thought about being angry and irritable, and you'll find your own way of saying it. It won't always be the same. It's just the desire just to have a camaraderie with people and share and be ready to share. And somehow you'll begin to, I don't know what it is, I'm talking about in the airport. I used to do a lot of traveling. People attract. They're looking for a place to sit, and there's all the places to sit next to me. And pretty soon, they talk to me about problems. I had a rabbi once. He sat next to me in the airplane. A couple of hours we spoke. He just couldn't leave me alone. He said, how do you know all these things? What all he got is verses and chapters. It doesn't do anything. Verses and chapters don't mean anything, but they do mean anything if you understand what you're reading or what was being said. See? So what you need is, yes, the Bible's good. Yes, you can listen to a preacher, but you're usually listening to a preacher who doesn't even know what he's talking about himself. He's just making everybody feel better, making people be religious in one way or another. And there's thousands of ways of... There's thousands of cunning like that. There's thousands of them. That's why you have so many different preachers. How many different Christianities do you have? Which one is right? Why do you have a lead? They have to go to church every week. All you need is a Bible. That's it. And this is how you do it, according to the way I would teach a child. Open the book. If you want a book, don't read it. Click, 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 click. See, when I started my physics, I knew nothing about physics. I had a very basic book on physics by Einstein and written with somebody else, in conjunction with somebody else. And it was very simple stuff, but the language is a bit unusual. I really couldn't understand it. And I went back and went back and just picked it up. All of a sudden, just one click, one thing, and 35 years later, I have the whole secret of life, how gravity is created to this very day, and how it's a push force. And then I look at the scientists. It begins with stuff, which doesn't make any sense. How can you begin with stuff? You need something that can change shape, like a river, like a flow, from one place to another continuously. See, it just came to me that in life, if you want to know an answer to something, in me it was physics. I don't know why physics, but that was on my menu to be interested in. I could conceive of what gravity is. First of all, I discovered what gravity is, and I made some diagrams. And to make a point that it's a push, that's it. And I've got that far. But I had to understand the original of it. But what I had in my mind was the fluid, the moving of a river. And if the river can't empty itself into the ocean, it doesn't go anywhere, it stops. So what we've got is, on this earth, God has given us a river, not just because a river is part of all of creation, but to me, it was a learning curve. I see the rain comes down into the lake, and the lake overflows into the river, and the river flows into the accommodating ocean. But it's energy. It's flowing. It's forever flowing. It's forever flowing. It's forever flowing.
If God comes into us, we being the river, then our godly love then flows out to something.
But look how beautiful it is. Mm-hmm. It goes to what you want to say more. So the river's flowing. But you ever seen a river? It tells me something else. You have a little eddies. On one side, on the other side, it goes the opposite way. It comes together, right? First particle. But the point is, then, one more thing. So that there's only one little, eddy. Only one. But look what one does. It's the river becoming solid. It's the river spinning, but it's not yet matter. It's still river spinning, very fast spins. And when it spins, it's gyroscopic. And when it's gyroscopic, it doesn't want to move. It wants to stay there. And the river pushes against it while it's going along, but pushing it. And the curve around it goes right past it. That's called time. And therefore, it manifests as matter. See, the curve, the pressure, first of all, it's a spin, the curve, so it tends to resist the ocean. It tends to resist the current. The spin is the current. It's taking another form. It's still the river. It's a little spin now. It's spinning, 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 and it wants to stay where it is, even though it's being pushed very fast. It's still resisting to some degree, and it resists, and the river now curving around it gives it an identity of the tiniest matter, dark energy. Dark energy is the river. Dark matter is the spin. Still can't see it, so small. But it's matter. Dark energy, dark matter, you can't see it. It's so small, the microscopes and everything can't find it. But the river is teaching me something. It's a replica. If the river stops flowing, all the matter, everything disappears. It's got to flow forever. Now, I won't go into this because what I've discovered, I'm going to keep a secret. But I know where the river is. I know it's there forever. I know it has a flow. And the ocean is the void. The void is infinite. So is the beginning. So is the heat, whatever that is. And it flows from one thing to another forever and ever and ever, with the cold retreating. Cold is retreating. See, because the void has to be fulfilled. The void is, it has to go into something. It has to be an accommodating something, and it's the void. In the beginning, there was the void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. It's all going together to me. I don't know about your brain, but I've written it down in a way. It's very hard to explain. What I'm saying is the adventure is what is magical. I don't want me to, don't tell me about this. But you can be a good scientist in a sense. You know what to do with this, you know what to do with this, and this got this quality, and this one's got this particular essence, and you know how to build things. But you don't know where it comes from. You have no understanding of the cause and effect becoming cause of all this. That leads me to a spiritual world. And there's something inside me that says, see, that river? It's like that. I made the universe. Oh, now take a look how that really works. Oh, I see it. See, that's an adventure. I'm only saying this because I'm blabbering, because it's not easy to say. But you can understand the river. It's always being replenished. It's always flowing. And if there was nothing to flow into, like the void is ever, forever. The void is forever. The nothing. The absolute void, it flows, and it becomes gravity. It's displacing the absolute nothing with something you can't also see. It's our universe. It's flowing. And then it begins to go round and round and round like a ball of string. It's all programmed. The whole thing from the very beginning is programmed. Everything that you see comes from that basic principle. It's a river flowing energy forever. And you can tell that because the universe is expanding. There's an infusion of energy, if that's the case. Especially, can you imagine a universe expanding? I hate to get in science a little bit, but the universe is expanding, getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, never stopping, but the temperature remains the same. That tells you energy is coming in. And they talk about it, but they just don't understand what they're saying. Energy is still coming in. It's still built. And the spin is maintained by the flow. If the flow stops, it all disappears.
As you speak about that, as human beings, that principle stands within our own selves.
Because yes.
That when we cease to exist, God still is, which is who we are.
You have eternal life if you don't have eternal strife. You're stuck up with yourself. If you could just stand quietly and let the light come in, and let you show you all the things that are relevant to your journey, and you do not know what that is, the smart woman and the sensible man does not try to struggle with memory. He doesn't know what's going to happen next. He just waits for the next things to happen and knows exactly what to do and what time, whether it's timely or not. It may not be timely, and so he'll know not to say it. If it is timely, he knows to say it. But everything is given to him all the time, never ending. Just like the dark side does the same thing backwards.
You said it so perfect. I think it was last week I watched you on your Sunday morning, where you said, as you said, the woman, the little girl, is a continuation when it's born through the mother.
That's right. The mother's dangerous. Mother is dangerous.
I understand that.
A man can't yield to a woman's fancy, and he cannot enter her without being gracious and not want to use her for his pleasure. Not that the relationship isn't pleasant, but not to use her.
Right.
See the difference? And it becomes addiction and puts a dark side, emboldens the dark side of the woman that needs to say, put the food down. See that? In other words, it expresses itself in trying to overcome him in many different ways.
But we can't tell them to put that down, because then it takes away our power over them.
That's right.
So it truly isn't. You said something else about words that fascinated me, that when people speak, behind it, there's a tale that also comes with the spirit, a spirit that comes in with words. And that's what I'm seeing, is that the wrong spirit needs to exit that way through me. So then you can just have...
Well, first of all, you get lost a little bit.
Okay.
First of all, you have to recognize that the authority... There's an authority inside you that was put in you, and when you came into the world.
Okay.
And as a woman, basically it slides into you. But when a man is born and he becomes infected by what's in her, unless the husband knows how to tame her, and therefore the child is free. I had to learn it the hard way. So my family is that's not perfect. You see, I'm at war with some of them already.
But that's their journey. That you can only do what you can do, and then your children have their own journey they have to go through.
Yes, they have to go their own, yes. Yes. Yes, but see, I didn't know.
Right.
I didn't know when I got married what was lurking there. And there is something lurking there. Mm-hmm. And when you're married to it, they own you. Especially if you say till death do you part, you mean it. Therefore, they have you by the, if you know what's mm-hmm. right. See, so I've been 64 years married. Still, she doesn't get it. See, she doesn't get it. You get it. She doesn't. What makes it difficult is I'm husband. What's it like to be Roy Masters, married to Roy Masters?
Hard.
But you need to ask me. It's called hell.
Yeah.
But the thing is, what keeps me, it's necessary for me to go through that. It has a value. It has a value. 64 years, still hasn't got it. But she's beginning to dim. It's affecting her, infecting herself more. I tried every day. In the morning, in the afternoon, in the evening, just to try to make a point. And the point makes her shrill whack. A little bit, no pressure. Stop. See? It's a bit out of order. You can't just ignore it. You can ignore it either by not saying anything, but not reacting. It's okay not to say something, but not react. The key. So whether you speak or don't speak, something speaks, even if it's the radiation of your body. And so what's happening is, I'm 88 years old. My wife is 84 years old. She has a nice side to her, but then the other side takes over and tries to overcome. And then she tends to resist it, like, you know, I'm accusing her. But not accusing her, I'm trying to get her to see something. But you can't force that. You have to endure it. And if enduring it is necessary, I do. If it's another 64 years, I'm okay with it. But I wish it would be otherwise for her.
Sure.
See that? Because what's in me is, if you don't mind me saying it, it's very strong, but let me talk about the negative. If a man does not understand what's in a woman, she will kill him and cause him to commit suicide and to rush off with other women who do the same thing. He's completely finished. And with Obama, making women more loving than men. The truth is, men have potential love that could cure the whole universe. The trouble is, it's all backwards. And they serenade and put to music the love of a woman. All she's doing is mothering the stupid fool, right? The stupefied fool. Okay.
I'd like to add something to what you're saying. Not only is the man finished, the woman is finished.
She's finished as well. They're both perish. That's the sad part. So I can share with you my relationship. It's only fair for me to talk to you about mine. So I'm not so high polluting person. I mean, I have my problems, but they're not problems to me. They're problems to her. Push me, I don't push back. I just hold my ground, and I have a very strong voice, and that upsets her more. But it doesn't upset me. I'm just saying what I need to say. See that? And so therefore I get better. I never hold back, or I will hold back when it's appropriate to hold back. It's all those times I'm always given, but there's such a danger to want to strangle her. you gentlemen, you understand? I'll watch that. See, watch it every now and then. It's there. See, I'm no angel, but the point is, I see it. And it's still there. Oh, goodbye. Nice knowing you.
So, when a woman is searching, and the husband, I don't want to say.
You're taking up all the space here, but you're very interesting.
Does somebody else want to talk?
No, you're just doing fine. You're talking for everybody.
My question is, what do you give to your husband without taking from him? Just to be in the room with him. So just to be in the room with him can be a challenge.
Yes.
So
keep up with that. Just keep going with that. Would you?
Okay,
Because it comes back to how you were feeling before.
Okay.
It comes right back to that.
So this is all I can tell. I can only be truthful with what, right now, he's reading a lot on his phone, hours and hours. He reads on his phone. He has an iPhone, and he's reading about the Constitution, how to better, you know, see. But I can see that he's lost in that, even though he's lost in a good thing. He's still lost.
Is your husband a decent man?
Excuse me?
Is your husband a decent man?
He is.
Yes, so leave him alone.
Okay, well that's... So,
don't let it bother you. Because what you're saying is he needs to give me some attention.
No, I'm... But I...
Yes.
It sounds like it.
No, that's true. That I want attention, and then I can see that
don't.
I'm judging him. So
there it is. There it is. There okay. it is. Right there. Hold it.
Okay.
It's right there. Oh, you want nothing from him. You only want to do kind things for him.
Okay.
And whether he appreciates you or not, you still do the right thing by him. And if he loses his temper, you do the right thing by him by not being angry. Or listen to what he has to say, because maybe he's right. You've got to take, if it's a correction. But the trouble is, he does not know how to correct you.
That's well, he tries with...
But he doesn't,
I can feel
he doesn't have the authority.
No,
he doesn't have the authority.
Right.
That's the problem, isn't
right.
it? So he can
right.
yell at you and try to help you, but what is there, where it's in me, it's not in him.
Right.
You could take it from me, but you can't take it from him.
But I can feel judging him as you're speaking. I can see that he's pretty much screwed, because I can feel that no matter what comes out of him,
that he's irritable.
Judge, he's irritable.
He's irritable because you you've sort of spoiled his focus on his iPhone and things like that.
Yeah, but yeah. I mean, I can see where even something good coming out of him, because it's not coming from
a good place.
What I think is a good place.
Yeah,
and he's judged anyway. So. I just have to see that.
Yeah, but you don't want to be resentful because it's not coming from a right place. Let's say it's the right thing, but it doesn't come from a right place. Look how subtle this is going to be.
Right.
He's not coming from a good place, but he says the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
That's good for you. Did you understand that? What, you can open up a book and it says something nice, you're not going to get mad at the book.
Mm-hmm.
So if he... Listen, people know a lot about things, but not in a holy way that we're talking about. Because I'm in the business, in the manner of speaking, of countering everything that's bad in you. It's a lot, but look how much better you get.
Mm-hmm.
So he doesn't have that, but he does have a modicum of what right and wrong is. So even if he is not perfect and is not fulfilled as he should be, if he says something good to you, be wise and say, you know, I never saw that before, but you do really see it. He doesn't. He knows, that may not do him any good, but it won't do him any harm. As a matter of fact, he'll feel better that you actually listened to him for one time.
And
not hate him because he isn't perfect. You know, you could... A woman can actually make a man. It's hard to talk to a woman. There's 60 words where one's meant.
Right.
But men are not that way. If a woman can just be calm, outspoken, and tell the man something he should be seeing for himself, the chances are that you'll be tapping into something really good in him. So that little thing with the goodness, he's telling you something good without knowing, you know, without the authority, still good for you. Wow. And if you see that, you become transformed, even if it's similar to what I have my effect on you. In other words, he doesn't have to be perfect to tell you what's wrong, because he can see what's wrong. And so you know him so long that you see you've hated him even for telling you things that are good.
But you know what I can see about myself in this moment?
What?
He tells me something, whatever. I can feel that resistance of the spirit of Eve, where even I don't want him to get credit. I can feel this, like, thing inside of me.
What? Explain it better.
Well, I could see where you said it would help me.
But it would also help him.
I know, but what I'm telling you is I can feel the spirit inside of me not wanting him to even have credit for that.
Yes.
And it's yes. so sad, because the trickery is just...
you know, you have to just really just sit here and be ugly. You have to just see that. It's just ugly.
When you go home, remember that. If is a modicum of good in him, be receptive to it. You say, if husband, you don't have to say all that, but husband, you know, that makes sense. Thank you for telling me. See, it is a spiral. See, you hate him, you reject him, and he's given you something good, even though he's not good himself. It's a good for that moment. And so, and if it takes, it doesn't make you inferior. Don't you understand when you actually, how many times do people in the audience, you know how much you teach me? You have any idea how much you're teaching me? I never been through all that crap you've been through. And so all the time you bring up your crap and I address it. But you're teaching me the crap, meaning I can recognize it in somebody else. And I'll be, all of a sudden everybody's got that. See that? I'm learning from you. Are you learning from me? I mean, learning from you. So I'm listening, and pushing you. I've never seen all that. I never had that. I've never heard all these experiences. You're coming back from hell. That's how I get it. Everybody who comes back from hell brings me a little bit of knowledge of what hell's like. And so therefore I can talk to you. I can talk to the hell inside you and say, how do you know this? Because I recognize it. I recognize it because you're not perfect. You're coming back from hell and you're bringing the stories with. So who are you to teach me? Just turn it around the other way. See that? You're actually teaching me a whole bunch of things. But it logs in here. It logs in here, not as verses and chapters. I see that. I see this over here. And I see something. What I could spend an hour after you finish talking, seeing different things that you never said, but you triggered it. You opened the door for me. What is for me? It might be different for us with you, but in principle, it leads to other things for me. And people say, "How does he know all these things?" I listen to people coming back from hell. I see how it works. And then when I meet people, how do you know this? I don't say what I just said. But I've got to be very careful that they don't put me on a pedestal for knowing all that. I just really do know it. I understand how it works. I see how it kills. And so when I spout it, it's real. I see it. I understand it. I get you to look at it that way, the best way I can. And I have the authority to tell you that. It's in my voice. And your husband doesn't have the voice, but he has the truth. So I can drive. I don't like to listen to radio. But when I used to drive and listen to it, I usually turn it off, the screamers. But I hear them saying things they don't understand themselves. Oh, that's interesting. But I'm not listening to the way he's saying it. I'm listening to the scripture I never read. That's interesting. So I go by the Bible. There it is. Oh, that's interesting. A month later, I'm educated. But educated, not educated, because epiphanies give birth to epiphanies. Earthy language gives forth to earthy language. The struggle with language, it will kill you. What you need is the wordless word. Men have it, women want it, expressed the wordless word. That makes a man more perfect, more easy to believe and to trust and to obey. obeying the spirit of the man. Now, your husband doesn't have it, but he has knowledge of right and wrong, even if he doesn't live it. But if he says it to you, it's still the truth. And even though there's no truth spirit behind it, there's spirit inside you to receive it. See?
I have a very similar situation to what Brenda's been talking about. And I just wanted to ask you, does it help my husband, or is it appropriate for me to share with him when I'm seeing things about myself?
You don't want to impose it.
I'm sorry, what?
You don't want to impose it. Okay. You test it.
Okay.
And it's the way you talk to him. Mm-hmm. You don't want to nag. You don't want to, how can I say it? There's got to be men, and a lot of communists here in this country want women to. The devil always sits on the doorstep of the woman. They know that, see, and make men into just sperm donors. It's this terrible thing that's happened in this country, that women are bringing up men. And they're not men at all. They're broken men, pansies, if you know what I mean. So, I forgot what I wanted to say. You say it again, it'll come back.
Okay. Would it help my husband? Yes. Let me go a little further with it.
Yes.
Would it help my husband to feel like I'm open to having correction if I share with him when I'm seeing
yes.
things about myself?
Yes, you know how you do that? You're sitting there because you've got TV and you've got all kinds of it. But you're having dinner and you said, you know what, I just discovered something, we'd like to share it with you. And so you see what you say about it. But don't push it on them as authority.
Okay.
See, because you're not the authority, you actually see something mm-hmm. that God has given you. Mm-hmm. But you've got to be careful, because you are the lesser of the two. Not less in a manner of speaking, but the man is in charge. He needs to have that captain of the ship. Mm-hmm. And you need to be the second officer, so to speak. It's got to have that order. It must have that order. And so you must respect that order, even though, listen, you talk to Obama, that's the worst human being I've ever seen, the most dangerous one. But you still gonna need to speak up to him appropriately, if you can. It's an office, but what is in the office? See, the office is a body, but the spirit of the office must be accounted for. So you have to recognize that even though he is not completely connected and has good authority over you, which you judge him for. You judge it for a man who doesn't really know how to deal with you. You know when he's sickly, looking for love. You know when he's rude and angry, etc., etc. So, but it's up to you. Because when men don't have it, women still have the ability to recognize when men have it or not. See, so it doesn't mean to say you don't know truth. You just see the truth of him. But you have to hold the truth of your place. So therefore, you must not talk down to him. And you mustn't talk up to him, mm-hmm. because that's enabling. See?
Yeah.
So you speak it from as, well, this is what I just discovered. Let me share it with you and tell me what you think. Attitude. That works.
Okay.
See? Got to get rid of your Eve. The desire to push it on him, and if he doesn't understand it, and you got the idea, just like he has an idea, mm-hmm. and he should recognize it. But it's easier for a woman to accept a man than a man to accept the woman. See that?
Yeah.
So you're in a special position, because you're closer to the dark side of the force. The women are closer. It's operating there. And when man born of woman, it's in him. And the woman created giving birth to a daughter, it slips in there, just nice and easy. So men are boys are confused by being born, more confused, confounded. Mother fusses over him as if she could make him. No, it is the father's role. But the trouble is the father wasn't a husband to her. So she has to take over, and it's all over. It's so magic. It's a magic. I can say it over and over and go over again. It's so simple. Once you grasp it, it's all over. It's natural. Once you grasp it, it takes one to know one. So I'm coming from a special place. I say, my marriage is a failure. Or it's not a failure. I'm not a failure. She's not listening and she gets irritable when I try to tell her. But I don't get frustrated. I just wait and wait and keep saying it often. And excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, it just pisses her off. And she either gets better or dies. She's getting more feeble. I don't want to see that happen, but I can't accommodate that. I become feeble too. See that? If it's the last.
Apply for our own selves.
Pardon?
Then that would apply for our own selves also, to not give in to physical pain. Just deal with it gracefully.
Everything. You know my story about hospitals. Mm-hmm. I've been through hell. I never flinched. If I'm going to die, I die. See that? Simple.
I worked somewhere. I worked at a place called Master Brand, and I had to hold onto the door really hard, like this, and then I wiped it with this hand. And the person training me was like, go faster, do it harder. And I wanted so much to please them, and I wanted everyone to like me and think I was doing a good job. I ended up with tendonitis, and now it's gone up to my elbow. And I see that is an effect.
Go ahead.
It's an effect.
Of a cause.
To something that I did. And so now it's there. I don't know if it's damaged. I don't know. But I just see it, and I just saw that the other day.
When you try to please, you paralyze yourself. Because you can never succeed. You could, damned if you get it, damned if you don't. Damned if you get it, you enjoy it and you try harder because you like what's coming back. Then afterwards you hate what's coming to you because you're beginning to feel like a slave. But you can't understand why I'm going to feel like a slave. Maybe if I love it more, maybe everything would be better. And you try harder and harder and harder. And then you've got tendonitis or whatever it is. I mean, the diseases actually can have a different. If you take 95% of all misery and suffering, wars, sickness, problems of family, mental illness, you take 95% of everything that's wrong with a country, everything is wrong with the world, everything is wrong with everybody. It's only one thing. Is that you, here it is from the very beginning. Everything I've said starts with this. You see injustice in the beginning. You're a child. All of a sudden there's a little irritation. Now, I want you to understand the difference between anger and irritation. Irritation, you could be smiling at a person and they're talking down to you, or you see that they're a hypocrite. And all of a sudden you feel an irritation right about here. And that's what you watch. So, and this irritation opens a portal. And through that portal comes these two things, the energy of the animal called stress. Animals live by stress. They get stronger by stress. We get weaker by stress because we're not a stress creature. We're not an animal. The stress, if you react to it, if it's pushed on you too hard when you come into the world, temptation. The word stress is temptation. Another word for it is hypnosis, hypnoidal. It will take you away from the counter stress of living forever. See, because you have this when you were born. You have this ability to see clearly and to potentially unfold like a flower. That's it. No ending to it. No death. No misery. No suffering, no matter what you do. If they're going to shoot you, okay. See you on the other side, maybe you go on the different side. Attitude holds your ground. But that's a gift. That's a gift. They take you away from that gift from the day you're born, practically. And they implant something in its place. And that's a different metaphysical world. It's the dark side. It speaks through you. And it uses language. But the knowledge of good and evil is knowledge, language. Knowledge of good is just as not bad as knowledge of as bad. Just as wicked. Hypocrisy. Self, telling yourself how wonderful you are, telling other people how wonderful they are when they're not, manipulating them. See that? It's all words. Words cease to become important. So when whoever you are, wherever you go, you can see people talk, you can see people not talk, and you could see everything you need to see. There's so much of it, but the part that's going to come at you is all, it'll be there before you, before they can even open their mouth. I tell you some things you can't believe. I told you my gang story. Remember my gang story? So what made me go in the middle of the street while the gangs were going up and down with their cars? You know, I live in Ventura Keys on the water, and just one space away, there's 20 or 30 of them. And they're going up and down the street and ruining everything. What makes me go out in the middle of the street, my wife and children standing there, and say, "Hey, who's your leader?" And they didn't take much notice at first, going up and down the streets and with the cars going like this. You know how they do that, making fun of you. And I put up with it for a while. What made me go out in the street and stand there and let them knock me down? What did that? God. No, it's not, yes, it has to be God, but it wasn't courage. You can't say this, because how I would say it, how else would you do it? Now, people will say that they wouldn't do it. Somebody's going to do it. That somebody now happens to be me. I find myself standing there with my legs, feet glued to the ground. And so, stop. And so they don't know what to do. And so next morning, there are people, the gang is milling around, having defecated in the... This, you know, could do all kinds of things in that next door lot. I said, "Come on, who's the biggest?" That's it. What makes me do that? I don't know.
No choice.
No. It's no choice. It's not clever. Mm-hmm. It's not smart. Mm-hmm. It's not brave. It's...
It just is.
How else would you do it? That is the attitude. Not that I try to make myself... I've said the story many times. Why do I do this? I went to jail. I was practicing hypnosis, and they called it practicing medicine, so they gave me 30 days. I was, how can I say it? The whole jail was on fire. I was helping them to overcome. The newspapers were full. See? You couldn't stop me.
It doesn't cease to exist wherever you stand. What you stand for doesn't ever cease to exist.
It never ceases to exist. It's not me. I'm the agent. Therefore, it's not a big deal. My life is given over to what he wants me to do. And I don't know it. I don't hear him say, do this. I'm just doing it. There's no thought. Just like when you get angry, there's no thought. But you do all the wrong things then.
Well, some of those judges should be in jail.
Yes.
Some of those judges probably should have been in jail, and you saw the good in people, and you brought out the good in them.
Oh, yeah.
And maybe they wouldn't have reacted, or their attitude would have been much better and brighter if they would have had a good authoritative figure.
What are you referring to?
Well, like you said, oh, I went to jail, or you stood straight tall in front of all these gangs.
Well, when I come into the jail, you know, I have to leave my wife. It's not very pleasant in a sense, but it's okay. Come into the jail. They heard me. They heard who I was, and the inmates opened the Red Sea. I thought I was going to get. What's going to happen here? Before you know it, I was helping them, and the headlines hypnotist practices spells in cells. And the warden calls me and says, "Roy, this is political. Would you please don't do this?" I said, no, I'm going to keep doing it. So they put me in solitary confinement. Yeah. And so what happened then? The inmates that I was helping put together and made sure I had chicken every day. And then he calls me and he says, look, I'll give you 10 days for good behavior. So I only had added a spent for 20 days.
Well, they probably didn't want to get exposed, the other people that made the decision of putting some people in there. Like you, or others.
Do you understand what I'm trying to say? Effortless. I don't like to use the word compulsive, because I'm not compelled, I'm in agreement. You're compulsive because you have conflict with what is really in you. See? What was left behind. And so you just need to understand to see that this dark side of you, how can I say it? Faith to you is faith is, oh dear, it's doubt. Doubt is faith, which you cannot resist. If you think of it, in other words, I had a little girl call me on the radio the other day, and she says, Grandpa, she calls me, she's 9 years old, she's the same one. Maybe you heard it last Friday, I think it was. She says, I want you to help me. I can't stop thinking that I might get cancer. So she says, it keeps telling me that. I says, but if you keep believing that, you will get cancer. She understood that. It's only because there's something inside you telling you this, and you don't have to believe it. It's making you doubt what is pure. It's not going to tell you, God's not going to tell you that you're going to have cancer. Something else. She understood that right away. Gone. A child is easy. She's been following me for a long time, since she's a little girl.
But I believe that that's also, I'm in that same spot now where I can believe. I can see and I can.
I tell you not to believe anything that comes to your head.
I totally agree with you.
Anything that comes to your head, anything you can't see clearly, that's all. If you can't see it clearly, don't trust it. Mm-hmm. And if you hear somebody saying you're dirty, rotten, so-and-so, and he keeps on saying, I'm not a, you don't have to say, I'm a dirty, rotten so-and-so. All you have to do is look at it. It goes away. But if there's any anger, it takes. So now you've got to get rid of the judgment part. See, that's the God in you. Judge yourself, judge others. If you judge other people and then you feel guilty, you turn it towards yourself, you get ill. Suicide. What happens? That's where the variations of your misery is endless. But the principle is sit quietly. You see, the 7-minute meditation, the 7-minute meditation is simply a let me see if I can find a better word for it. It is knock and the door shall be open. Seek and you'll find, knock at the door. So I'm going to show you where the door is. That's all. You don't see any religious words in the 7-minute meditation. You only see a system of close your eyes, make your fingers tingle, and it seems like, what's this for? It's because, well, I can explain it, but I'm not going to do it now. There's so much there. When you look at your eyelids, your eyes close, and you be aware of your fingers tingling. There's so much there, you cannot possibly grasp it. Because all of a sudden, everything starts to get better. What I've done is taken you to the door. Taken you to the place, the building, the street. I'm taking you that, and guiding you to that place. And all of a sudden, everything changes. All of a sudden, you're back in the driver's seat, as you were when you were a little kid.
You said something so powerful to me, I think it was last week. You said, as we speak, whoever, it's searching, as I speak to you, it's searching for an alliance. It wants to know, what will you accept me, or
yes,
will you not? And I think that's the beauty of the meditation, is it's just the stopping. You get to see, I do not accept, I do not accept, I do not accept. And you have to be able to see, like you said, you have to see it before it gets to you as it's coming.
Well, the reason for that is, in your intuition, you are not in the time zone. My consciousness does not exist in my intuition. The part of me that's spiritual exists in a place there's no time. 88 years, just like that, right? Time is only a place thing on the clock, so I have to make an appointment. Is this all it is? There's no anxiety. There's no space between this time and the time I go. There's no time. It's timeless. That timeless state is compatible with Creator. That timeless place. You are coming through that timeless. You are in a timeless place where He is. And you don't see Him. He sees you. And He gives you light. And who can explain it? It can't be explained. All I can do is tell you how to get there. And everything will happen on its own. And will come through you. But there's only two choices. It comes through you, or the crap comes through you. I was going to say S-H-I-T. Don't put it past me, I'm not all that perfect. But you see, in that space, that's where you need to be. Meditate unceasingly. Meditate unceasingly means you're there. You start the journey, and you sit quietly. And if you don't struggle, and if you don't try to remember anything, but just quietly do that little secret, it will reinforce in the first few weeks. After a while, you don't have to do any of it. You don't have to sit and meditate. You don't have to pray. Your whole life is subject, every minute. You know, and God knows what you need to ask. He actually puts it in your mind. You can have a you can have a ship or boat. It happened to me. It happened to me. It just, everything seems to come through you, comes through the into your dining room, and presents itself. And you can have this now. Or you get a good deal, like I'm Jewish. A good deal. But the point is, it's hard to make the point. Because you don't know what the point is yet. See what I mean? You just have to stay in that state. And just listen, look around, wonder, get no answers. Let me give you an example. I'm almost finished here for 2 hours here. I walk down the street. I'm walking. I'm going for a walk. And I see dandelions. I talk about that. Oh, that's interesting. Then I hear a baby cry. Why am I remembering that? Or all of a sudden, you know, I hear some music. Why do I remember each one of those things? It will be certain situations where you just will remember this for no reason. It's there, but it's interesting. I wish I could find expressions, because there are so many things that you could be shown. And some of those things are made for me, and some of the things are for you. And so after a couple of weeks, casually remember the baby crying and the dandelion thing floating through the air as a parachute and other things. These are just observations, but they seem to come together as an epiphany. All of a sudden, all those things that you said, I was talking about, suddenly it gives birth to an epiphany, and it opens your mind, like the river. See? I just see the river. Oh,
like see? Telescope.
Yes. And then time, because I'm standing on the bank and the river's going by, and I'm watching, I'm timeless. See that? All the things are going on in the river, I'm just watching it. No time. That is a way of saying it, because it really is time when you're watching, if you see what I mean. But in my mind, everything I see is only the moment. And I don't know what the moment holds, except I know I'm given to do it without thought, or I'm given to see it as to what to avoid. See that? Or to who would be a friend. And then I could be deceived. So 20 years later, oh, that's what it was. Oh, therefore, how much damage has been done for 20 years, I'm not angry. See? It's done me, I was meant not to see it, now I can tackle it. Oh, but now I got it. You better watch me, I'm coming. See what I mean? It all works for me. It's magical. Why wouldn't you want this magic? If you ask me what the magic is, I can't tell you. If you ask me how I get regenerated, I can't tell you. I'm no ordinary 88-year-old person. I'm no ordinary. I'm extraordinary, but I know that. I've been healed so many different times, new heart. New prostate, brand new. I sold the old one. Yeah. And all the trials and tribulations, I'm okay with it. It doesn't faze me. But it's not me. I can't claim that. I just enjoy it. It's called happiness. So my story, I don't know where I'm going from here. I think something very interesting is going to happen. My friend over there, he works at TRN. And he knows what we're going through, how the dark side of America crushed us. He stays with us. And he destroyed Talk Radio Network, destroyed it completely overnight. Things are beginning to come together again where we're going to be bigger than ever. Please God, I know it's going to be huge. So the dark side doesn't want us to speak. The dark side doesn't want talk radio. It doesn't want to hear the truth. And so one company bought up all the other companies and then didn't pay us. You know, it's betrayed us. Bingo. We're still here. He's here. Not that he gets his body, not that he gets the money he's deserved, but he stays with it, which is unusual. He stays with it because he senses that there's some good here. Isn't that right? No, he's a brother from another mother. He understands me. I understand him. I love him. He loves me. And he stays there under most difficulties. But we are coming to something. You'll read about this in the paper soon. It'll all be out. Huge. Biggest lawsuit in the whole world. We're going to win. And then we're going to be bigger than ever. Please God. All these things happen for good. All the things that go downhill can actually come together to go uphill. Because if you work for somebody and you are insecure, then you want to hold on to your security. You may be there for the rest of your life and forgot where you might have been. It's better that you get fired. See, rather than feel insecure and stay there. So you stand up and get thrown out. You get thrown out better places. See, if you don't stand up, things don't change. They only change for the worse, so they just make your life more miserable. You should have been somewhere else. See that? There's so many ways you can say all this. Right?
Absolutely.
Boom. Thank you very much. Anybody else have something to say before we close? Everybody happy now? You better? Mm-hmm. You're not screaming? Nothing screaming inside you now?
No, it's just that same little pressure that...
Watch nothing. It. Yeah. Watch it, don't get irritable. Okay. Watch it, don't get irritable.
No, I learned a lot today.
That's good. Thank you very much. And this lunch, no charge. Okay?
Thank you.
We have that because we're out in the boonies. And so... meaning that you're hungry and, you know, you can sit down and talk with each other, make friends, and have conversations. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We had a nice discussion. You were you actually talked to me for 2 hours, practically.
Thank you.
Yes. But you need to get it out, didn't you?
No problem stopping, because no, I'm sure, so if anybody just wants to tap me on the head, just not something hard, okay?
No, but you see her openness to express everything. But you see that many of you here are stuck with all those things because you don't want to bring it up. You need to bring it up. So next time you come, it's best that you say these things. So I can guide you with authority that makes you better. If I don't know, if you don't speak up, I can't help you, but I can actually see that you're doing it, but I can't. You have to volunteer. You have to confess in the manner of speaking. not confess like you do in the Catholic Church, because you make up anything to get to be forgiven. Thank you.